Hi, LA Progressive friends. We're back with our regular contributor, Henry A. Giroux, a distinguished professor and prolific author who appears with us once in a while. And this time we want to talk about your most recent article, which is titled, "Is the Right's Push to Whitewash History a Precursor to Fascism?" How are you doing, Henry?
Good. How are you? You both.
We're hanging in there. So yeah, this is a great piece that you've written. And, you know, I appreciate so much when we have opportunities to educate our readers. And that's exactly what this piece does. So let's talk about how you begin the piece. You're talking about the academic year ending in this past June, and the things that the far right has done, the types of attacks, and how these attacks kind of whitewash history. Can you talk a little bit about what kinds of attacks you're talking about?
Well, I think that we're talking about two kinds of attacks. One, we're talking about an increased level of overt repression against students, something that we haven't seen really since Kent State, in which school, higher education in many cases, particularly places where students are protesting against the slaughter in Palestine, the police are being called in, snipers are being put on roofs, and people are being arrested, students are being arrested, and faculty are being arrested as well, faculty who joined them. And I think this is a very dangerous signal. We've seen this before historically, we know what it means, and we're increasingly seeing it in the United States. And rather than it being a function of simply the government, we're seeing a lot of it being supported by right-wing institutions such as the Heritage Foundation and being supported by billionaires. That's the most repressive side, what we call the repression by the state. The other side is ideological. To me, it's even more worrying. There's an attempt in many ways to get inside universities, to get inside public education, and not just simply to defund them, but to begin to define what can be taught and what can't be taught and what education means and how we talk about history and how we talk about the habits of citizenship and how we're redefining basically the basic goals of education. When you tell faculty and you tell teachers and you tell young people that history doesn't matter, when you tell them that we can't talk about the past if it's uncomfortable, when you tell them that critical thinking is a curse, when you tell faculty that if they talk about abortion or race or critical race theory or slavery in the classroom, they can be fired, when you take away the conditions of their labor that they've had that suggest they can be autonomous, like tenure, as is happening in Florida, Tennessee, Wisconsin, and a number of other areas, you have to ask yourself, what is it about this particular moment in history that makes education such an incredible site of struggle by the right? And I think that what they've come to realize, though it's never been simply eliminated, they've come to realize that people who can think critically can act critically. That the institutions that protect the right for critical inquiry, protect the right of academic freedom, freedom of speech, all of a sudden have become dangerous, because public and higher education may be, in my mind, Sharon and Dick, one of the few places left that still hold the promise of creating informed and critical citizens. And in the age of rising fascism, as Hannah Arendt and a number of other people have said, my friend Zygmunt Bauman, that's dangerous. Thinking has become dangerous. But what's really horrible about this is that the people who reproduce the possibility for critical thinking, as well as the institutions that engage in it, are now under a full-fledged assault. This is just an outright assault, not just simply on education. This is an outright assault on the foundations that make democracy possible. So that's what the intent of this piece was.
Yeah, so you include a wonderful quotation from James Baldwin, which covers much of what you just said, that the idea of education ought to be to teach people how to think for themselves, to see the world and make their own chart their own course through their life. But the owners of this world don't want too many people around who are like that. So you cite two things. I mean, so the idea of what's going on with the repression of education is the corporate masters want to have corporate adjuncts, want to be the universities to be corporate adjuncts. That is training grounds for the kind of worker bees they need to so they can make more money. And then there's this parallel movement to turn them into Christian ideological training centers, right?
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, there are two issues here that we need to, I think, belong together. And one is there's been a longstanding attempt, particularly since Reagan in the early and late 1970s, to redefine schools as nothing more than adjuncts of corporations, right? You create workers, you don't create citizens. Workers are obedient, citizens cause trouble. You know, we don't want to educate people to understand what it means to connect justice to the workplace. We want to create students who basically can't wait to get a job and will do anything to do it. And that's all that really matters, that education is simply a vehicle for a paycheck and corporations should have an influence in deciding what the curriculum is about. That's not just about the death of the imagination, the critical imagination. That's about the death of what it means to define education as a democratic public sphere. The other side of this, which is new in many ways, is that the religious fundamentalists, particularly the far-right evangelicals, particularly since the era of Bush, where so many of the people who actually was in that administration came from these right-wing evangelical schools. Now, there's a massive movement to basically claim that education produces a particular kind of citizenship. And that's one that doesn't include Black people, doesn't include brown people, doesn't include critical people, doesn't include immigrants. What it really includes are people who are white Christian fundamentalists. So this is an attempt to turn education not just distributive of its critical functions. That's one thing, as horrible as it is. It's also an attempt to turn these into white Christian indoctrination centers. I mean, putting Bibles in schools and claiming that kids have to read the Bible every morning. I mean, you know, putting the Ten Commandments, putting them on a school board and making sure kids recite them every morning. This is unheard of in terms of its collapse of the line between the church and the state. It's a very enormously dangerous movement. And it's particularly evident under Trumpism. I mean, this is right out of Hungary. This is right out of the most repressive totalitarian states. And I don't think people have a sense, the American people have a sense of not only how dangerous it is to corporatize the university, but how even more dangerous it is to turn them into religious fundamentalist centers,
right?
And to shut down and expand even more so what we would call the circle of inclusion. The circle of inclusion is collapsing. It's collapsing politically, it's collapsing economically, and it's collapsing, if I can use this word, in terms of its spiritual possibilities. And I say that in a secular sense, making people aware of how who we are in part is defined by how much we care for others in terms of their differences and in terms of their liabilities. The other issue is, and I think that we don't talk enough about this, is that when we talk about the corporatization of the university, we're not just talking about creating people who become adjuncts of the corporation, worker bees, as you suggested. We're also talking about something else. We're talking about a notion that only individualism matters, only getting ahead by ourselves matters, only self-interest matters. Because what we're seeing here is a concerted effort to collapse the social. Any notion of the social contract, any notion of the welfare state, any notion of human connectedness that would bring together questions about what it means to keep the planet alive, but also more importantly, what it means to focus on inequality and what it's done to this nation and how it's created a ruling class of right-wing bigots and basically people who wanted to live either in the Confederacy or the Third Reich, who are now driving with their power conceptions of education, conceptions of injustice, conceptions that eliminate the American ideal in ways we've never seen before, because they have a cultural apparatus to do that. They have the power to do that. They can eliminate college presidents, you know, in Ivy League schools, no less, which are basically independent economically. And in the state schools, that's just a human tragedy unfolding before our eyes. And I think that at the same time, to see these young people all over the country, I mean, who have, you know, all over the world, who are Bangladesh, they're overthrowing governments. You know, they're putting their lives on the line. They're protesting at the DNC. I mean, they're saying, hey, look, there's another way to think about the world. And I say this with great emphasis. And what they're saying is education is not just about schooling. It's central to politics. If you want to talk about politics, you have to talk about agency. You have to talk about public consciousness. You have to talk about the tools that produce it. You have to talk about the identities that are being excluded. You have to talk about what has to be unlearned and not just learned. And I think that to me is a very powerful movement. And I tried in some way to do that in the piece by focusing on the question of historical consciousness, because I think we live in a culture of immediacy where the question of history and the question of learning from history and the question of what it means to unlearn from history has basically increasingly been eliminated.
Thank you so much, Henry, for writing this piece. I wanted to just briefly insert that this new and expanding role of the white Christian national is obviously detrimental and almost cancerous to the whole of society. Yeah. But I want to be careful to recognize that Christianity itself bears no resemblance to what we are seeing with this white Christian nationalist. And I say this as a Christian myself. I believe that the marriage of the state with Christianity is in fact anti-Christian, because one of the earmarks and features of Christianity is volition, free will. You should not ever be forced to take on a religion unless you yourself feel that you have had a conversion, or it's absolutely a personal decision. It is not a decision for the state to make, nor is it the state's authority to make decisions about your body. It's tantamount to that. So I just wanted to say that about that. I also wanted to say something about the anti-intellectualism that we see expanding. So we've come to a place that the only kind of education that is valued or appreciated is that of the white Christian nationalists. That in itself is anti-intellectual. And it just creates a population that is primed for being controlled and corralled and manipulated into doing things that are anti-democratic and not in the best interest of the people, but ultimately in the best interest of the 1%. So,
I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Henry. Take it away.
No, that's fabulous. I mean, it serves to remind us of a couple of things. You know, it serves to remind us of how the most progressive elements in any doctrine can often be appropriated and turned into their opposite. You know, I worked with Paulo Freire for 15 years. Paulo Freire basically was about liberation theology.
Mm-hmm.
And he believed that Christianity had something to do with justice. He believed that Christianity in some fundamental way had to do with hope.
That's right.
He believed that Christianity basically addressed the most oppressed and the most underserved. And that was the purpose of Christianity, to expand the possibilities of justice in the name of a spirituality that wasn't doctrinaire, but was rejuvenating, was energizing, offered a value system that people could inhabit and say, this is what it means to be a Christian. At the same time, it seems to me it was never a position that was anti-intellectual. It was always a position that in some way, I mean, think about it. Freire began working with peasants who were Christians and believed that the best thing he could do was to help them to be literate. Mm-hmm. Because to be illiterate was to be alive to the world. To be literate was to be able to understand who you were in relation to yourself and to be and in relation to the larger society. Everything that you've said about that notion of Christianity is anti-Christian. It has no resemblance to Christianity whatsoever. It uses Christianity as a cover for commercialism, for commodification, but mostly as a cover for fascism, because it believes you should surrender your mind, your critical faculties, and your agency to people who are going to provide you with a sense of prophecy that's really about death, and really about hatred, and really about bigotry, and really about, in some ways, being taken. I mean, you know, I mean, when you hear these preachers get up there and talk about how Christianity at its best serves people who do well and become rich, and that's a measure of what it, you think, what? What, I mean, what is that? That's a form of an ideological enslavement. I mean, we even do an injustice to calling it Christianity. I mean, you know, of course, we have to take their name seriously, but I think that, like anything else, you have to make that language visible for the hypocrisy that it embodies. And I think you're around that, Sharon, I think you're absolutely right. That distinction needs to be made enormously visible, because if it doesn't, if it isn't visible, you can basically fall into the trap of believing that we're talking about Christianity in general, because that's exactly what they want. They want to normalize the notion of Christianity that's all encompassing and leaves out its radical moments, leaves out its critical moments, leaves out its moments of compassion and social responsibility. The other side, and I think this is really important, is the anti-intellectualism. And I think that anti-intellectualism has to be expanded in terms of what the parameters and registers are. And I've been writing about this for a long time. We live in a society that basically eliminates any sense of the social. We live in a society that absolutely makes the claim that society is a war of all against all, right? That it's like reality TV. There's only one person left on the island. That self-interest is the only register of agency. That compassion is a liability. That justice is really to be measured only in monetary terms. That politics has to be driven by money. This is an evil system. Mm-hmm. But I think that what it does is it creates the conditions for a kind of anti-intellectualism that allows people to think in terms of themselves in ways that eliminates, and this is the most important part of all of it, any sense of social responsibility. When you say economic activity is removed from social cost, you're talking about the death of social responsibility. And I think even with respect to your commentary about the subversion of Christianity, what's at the heart of that? The merging of anti-intellectualism and ignorance, mm-hmm. and the death of social responsibility. That's the perfect storm for fascism. That's the perfect storm.
So these attacks on educational freedom are kind of coming to a head right now, I guess, as the right wing has become increasingly well organized and has gained some traction. But really, the attacks, as you say, go back to Reagan or before. And one piece of it is, you know, now a student graduates from college or even goes a couple of years, they're burdened with so much debt that they don't have much choice but to go run to a corporation and try to get the best job they can. But not everybody is, there isn't enough attention paid to this, but not everybody is taking this laying down. We have a new neighbor who, he and his wife were professors in Florida, and they couldn't take the repression, so they quit their good jobs there and came to California and got jobs that weren't quite as good. But you also conclude your article with professors and students are attempting to fight these changes. Would you like to talk about that?
No. I think as the repression becomes more intense, the nature of the oppression becomes less hidden. You know, when it becomes so widespread that, you know, you tell people they can't talk about slavery, or that teachers can be put in jail, that libraries can be turned into detention centers. This is not invisible. I mean, the force of repression has become so out so abrupt, so visible, that people are realizing something that they haven't realized before. They're realizing about, they're thinking about the interconnections. And one interconnection is, if you really want to disable students' futures and write them out of the script of democracy, then impose a system of loans and debt that basically amounts to debt and servitude.
Right.
The other side of this is that you have an enormous number of poor people who go into debt, who now for the first time in history are being criminalized and put in jail for that debt. Or you have parents in schools who can't pay for their kids' lunches and are basically being fined and criminalized. I mean, this, I understand something here. When the future becomes criminalized, social problems become criminalized. The more social problems are criminalized, the more resistance you're going to get. And I think that what we're finally seeing is a left, and young, and particularly young people, and in some ways faculty, who are now for the first time realizing that education has to be fought for. It really is too crucial to allow the right to continue like this. Look, I'm old enough to know, I've been in education for 45 years. When I went into education in the late 1970s, there were jobs. There were tenure jobs. The left failed here. They failed to fight a system that basically was casualizing the labor force in education. They should never have allowed that to happen. Now 70% of all faculty are basically on part-time jobs or are on short-term contracts. And there aren't enough of us to basically continue to fight this to make much of a dent. But students are fighting this, but they're doing it in alignment with social movements, and they're doing it in alignment with faculty that represent a force like I've never seen before. Remember, we don't just live in gated communities called nationalism anymore. You know, all of a sudden, these boundaries are fluid. Students are talking to students in Palestine. They're talking to students in Egypt. They're talking to students in this terrible place called Hungary. You know, they're talking to students in Turkey. And I think that what we're seeing educationally is a movement unlike anything I've ever seen before. That's a movement to basically embrace education as a public good and to see it as a fundamental element of what it means to fight for a world much different than the world that we're seeing now. And that gives people hope because it identifies the institutions, if I may put it this way, it identifies the places where the struggles matter. Not just in the streets, but matter long term. I mean, demonstrations are great. I love them. They have a pedagogical function, but they're not long term solutions.
Right.
They're not long term solutions. We have to take over these institutions. Imagine, Sharon, imagine, and Dick, imagine what it would mean if every faculty member in this country in higher education tomorrow went on strike. If we had Sean Fain, what's his name, the head of the UAW?
Sean Fain.
Sean Fain. If he was organizing this, shut it down. Just shut it down. Shut it down for a month. Let's see what happens. Let's see who has the real power here in terms of what action and resistance means. And I'm not surprised if that's not coming. I wouldn't be surprised. The repression is too intense right now.
Absolutely. And, you know, I can't speak more highly for the importance of education and shaping your minds. But I come from a tradition where, to tell you the truth, my son, my firstborn, was the first person in my family to have a degree, to go through a four-year program, a four-year college at Loyola Marymount University. And he was the first person dating back to since we were brought here in chains, the first person.
Yeah.
That's before me. So, but there's something that you brought up that I think is changing our world, and that's the internet. Because that's where most of my education, aside from my life experience, and yes, I do have a Juris Doctorate, but I did that without an undergrad degree. So this pedagogical function that you speak of, 10 years ago, I wouldn't even know what the hell you were talking about. But I know what you mean by pedagogical function, because that is how one of the ways that the internet can serve us. And for those that are concerned about misinformation, if you consume enough information with a critical mind, I think that it's you have the ability, it really arms you with the ability to make a distinction between misinformation, disinformation, and true information. But you know, and that's been my experience with Dick and I publishing over 45,000 articles over the past 17 years for the LA Progressive. Every single one of those articles, we read and edit. And that has been our pedagogical function.
Can I respond to that in a way that both celebrates and affirms? And certainly as an author, I would say I am enormously grateful you're here. And I want to begin with that on a more personal level. But let me say this. Look, the revolution that has taken place in the last 20 years, the most powerful revolution since the Industrial Revolution, is the merging of power, culture, and the new technology. That has expanded the notion of education in a way that doesn't offset schooling, but tells us that education is now central to politics. Mm-hmm. C. Wright Mills was brilliant on this. He wrote about what he called the power of cultural apparatuses and how we had to understand how these cultural apparatuses worked, what they meant, what their pedagogical functions were, and how they became enormously valuable political tools. And that's where I want to just make a comment. My point is that if you really want to make a difference today, if you want to learn how to think, you have to recognize that there are social spaces in this, amidst these new cultural apparatuses, like LA Progressive, like Truth Out, like Counterpunch, that really do offer alternatives. And that we have to educate young people not to be cultural critics alone, but to be cultural producers, to reproduce these things. You know, to be able to take that media and recognize that its educational function is overwhelming, and they have to use it. And they are, as you know. Secondly, there's the question of what it means to be a public intellectual in this culture. And I'm not just talking about faculty. I'm talking about journalists. I'm talking about artists and a whole range of cultural workers who need to use these sites, who need to be able to write, produce, in ways in which people can recognize themselves. We've got to get away from this nonsense of speaking in a language that nobody understands. You know, we've got to recognize that we have a social responsibility to reach out to multiple audiences, that language matters, that culture matters, that these sites matter, that podcasts matter, that these kinds of visual representations where you actually talk to authors matter. And I think that's the basis for a new kind of resistance that's emerging globally, because the right can't stop it. All they can do is just try to produce on their side and mimic it for the wrong reasons with dire consequences. I mean, look, and I'll give you one example, and maybe I'm wrong on this. You know, listening to the vice president the other day give her a speech, and then all of a sudden the switch to Truth Social. And you think, holy shit, I mean, this is like going from a party with your friends to listening to a corpse, yeah. You know, just a dead, I mean, a corpse. This guy's got blood in his mouth, right? Yeah. And that contradiction, Sharon and Dick, seems to be becoming more obvious to me. It just seems to be more visible, you know? There's a kind of visibility that's taking place that I think we need to push. And we need to see in some way as being, you know, very, very central to our politics. Look, we live in an ocular culture. We no longer live just in a print culture. And it seems to me that we have to take advantage of that culture and the language it uses, whether it's the language of images or whether it's the language of podcasts. I mean, those media are important because the generations that we're dealing with now live in that media. That's their media. That's their language. Our media, if I may speak for both of us, was probably Dissent or, you know, I.F. Stone. You know, I mean, you know, I.F. Stone's Weekly. It was a print culture. It's no longer a print culture. So how do we expand the spaces of education by recognizing that we have to, in some way, engage the technologies that produce it? And we have to create spaces and places where it becomes available, which you've done. That's basically what you've just said, right? 75,000 articles, a space where people can listen and read, have access to alternative information, a space that defines itself as political because it believes that people deserve to be political in the best sense.
Right. 45,000 articles. But 45. Yet, and what we have to focus on is ours is a repository. a repository of content, but we have to also design ways to reach out to generations who are not necessarily going to come to this repository.
That's right.
We've got to find a way to attract them. I don't think that they can learn or acquire a depth of knowledge that is necessary to sharpen their tools. They're not going to get that, I don't think, from TikTok. But TikTok can be a way to open a door that will bring them to develop an appetite for a deeper, more enriched understanding.
And the question here is not to believe that TikTok offers the last word in educating them. The question here is, how does TikTok open a door that would lead them somewhere else?
That's right.
I mean, look, one of the things that you probably know this, that now books that are like going off the charts are being pushed by young people on TikTok. Not the New York Times, TikTok. Yeah. There's a classic example. I mean, you know, where are the young people pushing left books, right? I mean, where are they? I mean, now we know that space. Somehow, if we can speak to young people and say, hey, look, use this space for us. I mean, for all of us, this is you can be a vehicle for social change by engaging in these, in these, how do you say it, these new spaces that, you know, in some way speak to joy. Look, when I talk about Kamala Harris, as I mentioned earlier, let me qualify something, okay? Well, I mean, I know what the politics are there. I'm not stupid. I'm on the left, you know? But I do see something there that I think we need to take seriously, and that is the language of possibility. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to combine the language of critique with the language of possibility. We need to talk about a future that rings, that in some way speaks of joy, yes. But not just joy as pleasure, joy as married to justice, married to a different sense of community. You have people in the United States and increasingly across the world who are enormously alienated. Leo Lowenstein, the critical theory people, were brilliant on this. They didn't say alienated, they said social atomization. They're purposely atomized, they're cut off, and they're dying for a sense of community and connectedness. And the right, almost more than anyone, has understood how to manipulate that. Mm. And they, you know, they get young people through video games, and all of a sudden they give them racist literature. You know, they organize communities with daycare centers and health, and the evangelicals have been doing this for years, right? Where all of a sudden the basic needs are being used in what I call the scandal of fulfillment. Mm. Community in the interest of hate. But as Marcuse used to say, the real question here is, what basic needs do we need to address that bring people in to a community of joy and hope, possibility, and justice? That's very different.
So you mentioned the circle of inclusivity or exclusivity. And I think what we saw this past week here in America with the Democratic Convention, I mean, I know a Harris-Waltz administration won't solve every problem, but I think, as you were just saying, I think it opens the door to change, to push against some of the repression we're seeing that would not exist if they lose the election.
I completely agree with this, Dick. Noam Chomsky and I had this conversation in 2016 against a certain element of the left that said, we're not voting for Clinton, blah, 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 all this bullshit, right? Look, if he's elected, millions of people are going to be thrown under the bus.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Millions of people are going to suffer.
Millions of black and white.
The foundation for fascism is going to get stronger.
Right.
The choice for me is not making the perfect choice. The choice for me is making a choice that will save human lives and recognizing that that choice is the beginning, not the end. That's to me what a politics of justice is about. I don't believe in political purity. I believe that strategy has to be the best it can under the circumstances in which it takes place without compromising your values, without being seduced by power, without being able to recognize that in that vision of the Democratic Party, there's some hope that needs to be pushed so far that all of a sudden the Democratic Party isn't necessary anymore. We have a socialist party. Mm-hmm. Right. That takes generations. That doesn't happen tomorrow, right?
That's right. And I'm with you, Henry. I don't believe that in the politics of purity. I think that if this buys us some time, we need to take it. That's what it does. It buys us time.
I can't tell you how supportive I am of that position. Mm-hmm. You know, it's easy to sit here on the left, not you, not us, others, and to say, oh, no, we need to overthrow the government tomorrow. And, you know, we're not going to vote for either party. And that's a protest vote. No, it's not. It's not a protest vote. It's complicity. Mm-hmm. It's complicity because it doesn't understand the complexity of strategy in the long term. Right? There's reformism and there's non-reformism. Reformism is you lose yourself in the Democratic Party. You have both feet in. My argument always is you have one foot in and one foot out. And you never have 2 feet in. And I think to me, that's what the long struggle through the institutions is about, that the left used to talk about in the 1960s, the long struggle through the university or through these various institutions.
Well, thank you, Henry. I think we need to start wrapping it up, but I really so appreciate these conversations and really appreciate the content that you provide, because sometimes it's hard to explain. Yeah. And you do such a wonderful job of explaining why it's essential that we understand our history, that we understand how we are being manipulated for lack of knowledge.
I mean, I just wrote a piece, I haven't sent you. It's going to be, it just came out in Counterpunch, called Scholasticide. And I love this piece. I really love this piece. And I'll send it to you today. But I think that, you know, it says that what's happening in Gaza with the destruction of universities, the repression that actually goes on in Israeli universities with Palestinian faculty and students, is the canary in the coal mine.
It is.
It's not unconnected to what we've talked about today in higher education. And in fact, it is very connected. And what we have to recognize is that what we see here, what we see there, is basically happening here in a very earlier stage. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think all of this has to be understood in terms of its connections and in terms of its being able to understand in terms of its possibilities.
That's right. I couldn't agree with you more. I've often said that the way that Black people treated in America is a canary in the coal mine.
That's a canary in the coal mine. That's right. You know, that's right. That's why we cannot point simply to Europe when we talk about fascism. That's a mistake. Fascism begins with slavery in the United States. That's fascist, right? And once we understand that, we can begin to see the connections so that we don't say, that's a European problem. Doesn't happen here. Are you serious? That's why history is so matter. That's why history matters. That's why this question of historical consciousness is always a struggle for those of us who really believe that the last thing we want to do is eliminate memory as a liberating force.
So as always, it's delightful to talk to you. We'll go pick up your Counterpunch article and publish that.
I'll send it immediately.
Awesome.
Okay.
Thank you
so much, Henry.
Have a great
Thank you so much for having me on. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.